Next, we'll be talking about strategies for designing algorithms and solving problems. This is just really a crash course. More about that you will learn in subsequent modules, but I hope that this helps you throughout this module to get started with designing your algorithms. Okay, when we design an algorithm, we have to think a bit about problem solving. Problem solving basically means to design an algorithm to solve a problem. Well, and there are a lot of different strategies that you can use. For example, you can ask yourself questions. How can I, you have this problem, how can I solve this problem? Well, one way of dealing with it is that you look for similar problems that you are familiar with, and then you try to apply these principles to this problem. Another approach is that you do a complete analysis from top to bottom. And lastly, you can try to divide the problem into subproblems and approach them individually. And of course, there is no single strategy that you have to apply. You can combine those strategies as you see fit. So let's look into all of these individual strategies. So by asking questions, we start with a high-level description of the algorithm, including questions. And then we refine these descriptions until resolved. For example, what, why, when, and where? What do you know about it, and what do you not know? Okay? In the context of problem solving, what is my input? So what do we deal with? How do these data items look like? How much data is there? How should my output look like? Okay, for example, I want to bake this cake, banana cake. What is my input? Okay. These ingredients, and my output, how does it look like? Okay, how will I know then when I have processed all the data, right? How do I know for our cake, for example, when it is done, right? How many times is the process going to be repeated? And what error conditions might come up? So there are a lot of more questions you can ask. This just gives you an idea. So look for familiar things in this strategy. Well, you try to look for similar problems, and you can, research them in the internet, for example, ask colleagues, or ask even in your family, sometimes depending on what kind of problem it is, right? If it is a tax return, it's also a problem sometimes. Well, you ask people that know about it, right? And the key goal is that you should never reinvent the wheel in programming, because there has been, thousands and millions of people have worked on similar problems, so you should use what they have done and benefit from their knowledge. So here's another example, finding the daily high and low temperatures. It's pretty much the same problem as finding the highest and lowest grades on a test. Yeah, we just, in one day time, we look for temperatures and the other one for grades. So you can abstract those problems as finding the largest and smallest value in a set of numbers. Okay, interesting. So means end analysis means you have the input and the expected end state, which is the output given. So now you have to define a set of actions to get from the input to the end. Once you have a coarse grain set of actions, you need to work out on the details. Okay, so always write down what the input is, how it is defined, all this data, and how the output look like, which is the end. And then you look at those actions, right? So when I showed you this little flowchart, you can also think of a lot of problems really look like that. So you read some user input, you do something else, and you show the results on screen. So that's very coarse grain, right? Now the next question is, what does do something mean? It could mean calculate the diameter of this 3D shape object or something, right? Okay, nice, so we write this down. Next, the question would be, well, how do we calculate it? Well, maybe we have a subset of steps, maybe we can find a math book, and so on and so forth, right? So we refine those individual steps until we know what they mean. Reading user input in this case could then mean, the shapes, the characteristics of the 3D shape that we input, that we want to calculate this diameter for, right? Okay, let's go back. So divide and conquer. So that is absolutely an awesome strategy. So you decompose a problem into smaller ones that are easier to handle. So imagine you have a very hard problem. One hard problem could be, I want to learn programming. Well, learning programming might be so hard to think about for you, you can't imagine to solve it. But maybe you can break down this problem into easier subproblems. One problem could be, well, understanding, for example, how algorithms work, right? Because they are the foundation of programming. So this is an easier subproblem. And also you have another subproblem, maybe understanding a programming language C. Okay, easier subproblem. Well, understanding the language C may again be refined into another subproblem, right? For example, understanding the syntax, and secondly, understanding the semantics. We talk about it. So you can always reduce the problem until at the end, each of these steps is so simple and easy to understand that you are able to execute it. And then you have your algorithm. Good, here's another example. Well, the algorithm is computing the area of a circle. The problem statement, we need an interactive program that computes the area of a circle. Given the circle radius, the circle area should be displayed on the screen. Well, we can represent it graphically using our algorithm box. So we have the radius R, and then we compute the area somehow, and we output the area. Here's actually the mathematical equation, how to compute it already. Then we have an input-output description. The input is the circle radius, the output is the circle area. Well, here's a natural language program. Read the value of circle radius R from the user, compute the circle area as pi times R, and print the value of circle area on the screen. Okay, that looks very simple. Maybe there is another problem as, you know, what does pi mean? Well, maybe we have to define that and so on. But basically, that's a very simple problem that we have just solved. So a divide and conquer block diagram of our problem could be like, so, you know, we have this program circle area, read the radius, compute the area, and print the circle area. Okay, and if we understand each of the subproblems sufficiently to solve them, then we are able to compute the circle area and write this little program. That's nice. If we don't, then we refine this little process that we don't understand yet. Okay, here's another pseudocode, which is a bit more verbose now. Prompt the user for the circle radius. Write a message on the screen. Read the value of the radius, and if the value is not valid, for example, a negative number, look at that. Print an error message on the screen, and now we get here to step 4, only if the value is valid then. Assign circle area the value pi times radius, and then finally we print it. Well, error handling is a little bit what we will address as part of the module, but let's not go into too much detail for now. So here's our program written as a flowchart. Again, and as our learning object has shown, you should be able to write such little programs and generate those little flowcharts by yourself. Well, have a look and try to understand this one. I think it's not a big deal. So now we approach another little group work. So you should sketch an algorithm with your neighbor, for example, how to make coffee, which is a very easy algorithm, I consider. Another harder algorithm is how to determine the range of a set of numbers. That means finding the minimum and maximum value. And remember, you can only use those three constructs, sequence, selection, and iteration. Okay? And you should be able to approach this kind of both of these algorithms, if you want, by doing applying those strategies and boiling the problem down into little dealable subproblems. Okay, and I will now wait for a moment. Please spend the time and think about it, right? It's really important that you understand algorithms and that you are able to do those little examples. You have now 3 minutes, and please pause now the video for 3 minutes and then continue. So here is now the more complicated algorithm. I'm not talking about the coffee example. We will do that a bit in the exercise as well. So we can call this algorithm range. So how can we do that? Well, we set the maximum to zero and the minimum to infinity. Well, maximum, by the way, we assume the numbers are all positive. Then we get the sequence of numbers, and then we start. Are there numbers left? That means, did we not process all of them? If they are, we get the next number. If the number is larger than the current maximum, then we set the maximum to the next number. And if the number is smaller than the minimum, we set the minimum to the next number. Well, and then we repeat this for all the numbers, basically these steps. And at the end, we'll find that minimum and maximum has the minimum and the maximum value as is expected. Try this out with a couple of numbers and you will see that it works. Here is the pseudocode, in fact, for this little diagram that you can go through. It's really the same algorithm, just written in a different fashion.